Clearly, I don't understand how valuable stories are, how deep they go, how the degree to which stories encode not only the wisdom of our ancestors, but quite possibly the wisdom born of the hard knocks of evolution of the species, right? So there's no telling how deep the significance of the information encoded in stories goes. And there's a class of stories that are religious stories, and they're religious for a reason, because they're dealing with the deepest questions in human life. They're questions about what constitutes a good life, what's worth living for, what's worth dying for. These are things that if each individual just thrust from onto the stage of his own life, not knowing where he is, and tasked with figuring out how to live all on his own, or even in a collection of others who are similarly unguided by ancient wisdom, this is not knowledge we can recapitulate for ourselves easily. And so we edit or ignore these ancient stories at our peril, at minimum at some considerable risk, because we don't know how much, we don't really know what baby is in the bathwater. And so we should have immense respect for these traditions. And this is as yet to be discovered tonight. I'm still not quite clear about how this links up with more metaphysical propositions about the origins of these of certain of these stories. But at minimum, my criticism of religion, because it tends to focus on the most obvious case of a zero-sum contest between religious dogmatism and, you know, scientific open-ended discussion, doesn't address this core issue of the significance of religious thinking and religious narrative, because I am, for the most part, just shooting fish in a barrel, criticizing fundamentalists. And the kind of God that the fundamentalists believe in, the God who's an invisible person who hates homosexuals, obviously that's not the deepest version of these religious, this essentially what is a narrative technology for orienting human life in the cosmos. So maybe I'll leave it there, but that's, I think, what Jordan thinks.
Yeah. All right, Jordan. Before you steel man Sam's point, how did you feel about his encapsulation of yours?
Well, I'm convinced, man. No, look, I mean, well, I got a couple of things to say about it. It's like, first of all, I think it was accurate, concise, fair. I also think that, this is a more technical note in some sense, is that if you ever want to think about something, that's exactly what you have to do. Right, you want to take arguments that are against your perspective, and you want to make them as strong as you possibly can so that you can fortify your arguments against them. You don't want to make them weak, because that just makes you weak. And so, you know, Sam and I are both scientists, and it really is the case that what scientists are trying to do, and I think what we're actually trying to do in this conversation genuinely, is to try to find out if there's something that we're thinking that's stupid. You know, because when I'm laying out the arguments that Sam just summarized so well, I've tried to generate a bunch of opposition to them in my own imagination, and the arguments I put forward are ones I can't undermine. But that doesn't mean they're right. It doesn't mean that at all. And so if someone comes along who's, and this is certainly the case if you're a scientist who's worth his or her salt, if someone comes along and says, hey, look, you've made a mistake in this fundamental proposition, it's like, yes, great, that means I can make progress towards a more solid theory of being. So, and that's what we're trying to do, and I do think it's working, and so I thought that was just fine, exactly dead on, and I hope I can do justice to your position as well. So, okay, so I'm going to summarize Sam's argument briefly, and then I'm going to tell him, let you guys know why he thinks I'm, things, what things I'm not taking into account. So, Sam believes that there are two fundamental dangers to psychological and social stability. Religious fundamentalism, essentially on the right, and moral relativism and nihilism on the left. And so the danger of the right-wing position is that it enables people to arbitrarily establish certain revealed axioms as indisputable truth and then to tyrannize themselves and other people with the claims that those are divine revelations. And he sees that as part of the danger of religious fundamentalism and maybe religious thinking in general, but also as something that characterizes secular totalitarian states that also has a religious aspect. So that's on the right. And then on the left, well, the problem with the moral relativism nihilism position is that it leaves us with no orientation. And it also flies in the face of common sense observations that there are ways to live that are bad and that there are ways to live that are good that people can generally agree on, and that statements about those general agreements about how to live can be considered factual. Now, so, and then the next part of Sam's argument is that we require a value system that allows us to escape these twin dangers. One stultifies us and the other leaves us hopeless, let's say. And that value system has to be grounded in something real. And the only thing that he can see that actually constitutes real in any provable sense, and there's a certain amount of historical and conceptual weight behind this claim, is the domain of empirical facts as they've been manifested in the sciences and technologies that have made us incredibly powerful and increasingly able to flourish in the world. And so we need to ground our value propositions in something that we've been able to determine has genuine solidity so that we can orient ourselves properly, so that we can make moral claims and that we can avoid these twin dangers. We can begin with some basic facts that we can identify, as I mentioned briefly, what constitutes a bad life: endless pain, suffering, anxiety, tremendous amount of negative emotion, short-term lifespan, all the things that no one would choose voluntarily for themselves if we would all agree that they were thinking in a healthy manner. And we can contrast that sort of domain of horror with the good life, which might involve, well, certainly freedom from privation and want and undue threat and anxiety and hope for the future and all of that, and that we can agree that those are poles, good, bad, and good, and that that's a factual claim. So Sam also claims that we can define the good life, this is an extension of it, with reference to flourishing and well-being, and that can actually be measured, and that we should and can inform the idea of flourishing and well-being with empirical data. Having said all that, he also leaves a domain of inquiry open that would be centered on the possibility that some of the ideas that have been encapsulated in religious phenomenology, if not in religious dogma, might be worth pursuing as well, that there might be wisdom that could practically be applied in terms of perception to spiritual practices, although those become increasingly dangerous as they become ensconced in dogma. And so that's Sam's position. And then his criticism of my ideas, he would say that it's facts, not stories, that constitute the ground for the proper science of well-being, and that we don't need to be connected to stories, ancient stories in particular, to thrive. And the reason for that are that these ancient stories are pathological in certain details, especially in the specific claims they make, which look outrageous in some sense from a modern moral perspective. And he believes that it's hand-waving to ignore those specific topics with an optimistic overview of the entire context. That they're dangerously outdated now, if they ever were useful. That they're subject to too many potential interpretations for any modern usage to be reliably derived. And so he believes that attempts to interpret these stories, let's say, are rife with so many potential errors of bias and interpretation and subjectivity that all the interpretations in some sense are unreliable, and perhaps equally unreliable. That they're that worse than that, not only are they unreliable, but they're dangerous insofar as the claims they lay out pose a threat to scientific and enlightenment values, which are the true saviors of humanity, as evidenced by our progress, let's say, over the last 200 or 300 years, and that they're also susceptible to the totalitarian interpretation, which I described earlier, which confer upon the interpreter a sense of and then a claim to revealed truth. And so I would say that's Sam's argument and his criticisms of my position. So,
okay, so you write my next book. I'll write yours. Yeah. Yeah.